legal trial, spit in his face, punch him, slap him, and mock him as a helpless prophet. Jesus silently accepted their mistreatment. Then he calmly confronted them for ganging up on him secretly and for abusing him when he did nothing wrong. As also we are told in Matthew 26:57-67, and also in John 18:19-24, they watched him being crucified. And he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." They sneered at him. He said, "Others, let him save himself if he is Christ." He prayed, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Amen? Amen. Jesus' response to aggression is revolutionary. It's so wise, so beautiful, so strong, and so different from what is normally done. In tense and angry situations, when he is being judged, beaten, or hit, you look at how he responds. He tells a story, asks a question, calmly explains, heals people, wiggles out our traps, and walks away. He prays or silently accepts the mistreatment in all cases. He holds his ground. He escalates the conflict without allowing it to get out of control and speak the truth in love. We leaders must also cultivate a habit. Many, many times we will face crisis in our church. Are we going to escalate it or de-escalate it? We have to diffuse it because we don't want to destroy what we have built. If we allow our anger to take control of us, we will escalate an avoidable conflict in the church and will later regret it. So we have to be very, very, very wise. And this is the message the Master is teaching us in Luke 14:4-6. "But they kept silent. And he took hold of him and healed him and sent him away. And he said to them, 'Which one of you will have a son or an ox fall into a well and will not immediately pull him out on a Sabbath day?'" What happened? There was a man who had been sick with withered hand for almost 30 years of his life. Every day he would come to the temple to beg for alms. And they would give him small changes. So this man now came one day when Jesus Christ was in the church and happened to be on the Sabbath day. And the hypocritical Jews, the Pharisees, they said, "You must not do work on the Sabbath day." So Jesus Christ said, "Okay, is that so?" He looked at the man. He had compassion on him. He said, "Stretch off your hand." So the man stretched off his hand. The man was healed. Then he said, "He performed miracle on the Sabbath day. He is not a prophet. He offended the law of Moses." And Jesus Christ looked at them and said, "Look at these idiots. Which one of you, if his own ox should accidentally drop inside a well, will leave that ox inside the well till the second day and not pull him out on that day?" He said, "You hypocrites." And they could not make any reply. Another classic example is found in Matthew 12:26-28. "If Satan casts out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? If I, by Beelzebub, cast out demons, by whom do your sons cast them out? For this reason, they will be your judges. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you." What are we saying? When they could not find any reason or to justify the miracle Jesus was performing to heal the sick, because they know it's not magic. So the next conclusion is that they don't mind him. He was using the power of demon to heal the sick. He was using the power of demon to maintain his church. And Jesus just looked at him, looked at all of them. He said, can a house fight against itself? If any house that fight against itself is not going to stand. If I'm using the power of Beelzebub is supposed to encamp people, and I'm forcing them out, I'm taking them out from his hold, how will his kingdom stand? He said, the kingdom of God is upon you, and your son will testify against you. So don't let anybody frighten you to do good. Do whatever is right, and leave the rest to God. Praise the living Jesus. I'm appealing to you all this morning to get acquainted with the words of God, to get acquainted with the scriptures. The more you ingest it into your system, the happier and liberated you become. I really thank God for my life and the relationship I share with the Lord and Master. And this is what I am also offering you this morning. Get yourself involved in Christ Jesus. And not just be content as a freelance Christian, a wishy-washy Christian, a deadwood Christian. Time is running out. There's no room for lukewarm Christians that are sitting on the fence. You're either on the right side or the left side of the fence. The Lord said in Luke 9:61-62, and then thou also said, I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home. But Jesus said to him, no one. After putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Many could not worship God anymore because they were tired after working overnight or attending late night party. And I thank God after our picnic, we are all of us here this morning. I was really afraid. Maybe I will not see anybody to speak to this morning. So I spent the whole night praying for God's church members to come. You see, so many could not worship God anymore because they were tired after working overnight or attending late night party. We find different excuses to justify our lack of will to serve Christ. If you know such people, do not ignore them or leave this job to the servants of God alone. We are all ambassadors for Christ. Talk to them. Evangelize for Jesus. Who knows? You may be the one Christ wants to use to save his soul from perishing. I would like us to consider these few practical solutions to dealing with a person who is rude, insulting, or unkind to you. No matter how gentle, how good and generous, or how friendly you may try to be, you may one day be faced with a situation to enforce discipline or correct a situation considered not in the interest of others. And in the process, you are faced with an angry person who yells at you. How do you handle such situation? As a leader, you can't please all the people all the time. You just cannot. It's not humanly possible. Do you yell back and aggravate the situation? Or just walk away or apologize and swallow your words as if nothing ever happened? These are situations we are all going to be faced with as we grow up and accept responsibility to maintain law and order, either in our community or at home, in our church or in our office. The youth will become leaders one day, and you'll be faced with this responsibility. You have to accept that we are all now in Christ's storm-broken world, where Satan and his demons are fully influencing the affairs of men. Satan is roaming about. He's not resting at all. So, one, don't get all dramatic or aggravated when you are insulted or yell at. Always remember that your aggressor may not be in full control of himself or herself. Always remember, if anybody insults you, yell at you, have sympathy for them. Like the First Lady said in the Democratic Convention, he said, if these people decide to be toast.